Breaking: Obama busted after what he was caught hiding in massive raid. He had it for 6 years. The CIA has finally released 470,000 files recovered from the raid on Osama bin Laden's compound. And here is why it took so long. Less than 24 hours before the President Barack Hussein Obama would vacate the White House on January 20, 2017, the Director of National Intelligence James Clapper issued a press release which was aimed to put to rest the controversy over the large amount of documents gathered during the raid that killed Osama bin Laden. The CIA has finally released 470,000 files recovered from the raid on Osama bin Laden's compound. And here is why it took so long. Less than 24 hours before the President Barack Hussein Obama would vacate the White House on January 20, 2017, the Director of National Intelligence James Clapper issued a press release which was aimed to put to rest the controversy over the large amount of documents gathered during the raid that killed Osama bin Laden. The Office of the Director of National Intelligence announced in January. Today marks the end of a 2.5-year effort to declassify several hundred documents recovered in the raid on Osama bin Laden's Abbottabad, Pakistan, compound in May 2011. Accompanying the press release were 49 documents captured during the raid, bringing the total number of documents made public to a whopping 571 official documents. Nice try. But what was really odd about all this is that in the immediate days after the May 2nd Abbottabad raid, President Obama's National Security Advisor, Tom Donilon, had gone on to describe the intelligence haul brought back from Pakistan by the U.S. Navy SEALs who carried out the mission and from CIA operatives in attendance as being large enough to fill a small college library. A senior military intelligence official who briefed reporters at the Pentagon on May 7, 2011, said, "As a result of the raid, we've acquired the single largest collection of senior terrorist materials ever." But later in Obama's presidency, all this only amounted to 571 documents? That's a large binder, not a small college library. In a powerful and comprehensive piece in the Weekly Standard, editor Stephen Hayes delineates in detail how the Obama administration hid almost 500,000 documents seized from the raid on Osama bin Laden's compound in order to perpetuate the lie that Al-Qaeda was defeated after bin Laden's death, thus paving the way for Obama's 2012 victory. Hayes begins his odyssey into the Obama administration's duplicity by noting that the day before Obama left the White House, Director of National Intelligence James Clapper had the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, ODNI, issue a press release claiming the administration had declassified enough documents seized in the raid to close the book on bin Laden. The release was even titled, "Closing the Book on Bin Laden: Intelligence Community Releases Final Abbottabad Documents." Yet after the May 2, 2011 raid, Obama's National Security Advisor, Tom Donilon, said the documents seized were extensive enough to fill a small college library. As Hayes points out, a senior military intelligence official who briefed reporters at the Pentagon on May 7, 2011, said, "As a result of the raid, we've acquired the single largest collection of senior terrorist materials ever." Hayes writes, "Why would ADNI think it could get away with such an aggressive lie?" In this context, ADNI's bet wasn't a crazy one. No one outside of a small group of terrorism researchers and intelligence professionals had paid much attention to the fate of the bin Laden documents. The likelihood that these ADNI claims would get much scrutiny in the middle of the frenzy that accompanies a presidential transition was low. He continues. In the spring of 2012, with the Republican presidential primaries nearing an end and shortly before the first anniversary of the successful raid on bin Laden's compound, Obama's National Security Council handpicked 17 documents to be provided to the Combating Terrorism Center at West Point for analysis. The West Point documents were shared with Obama-friendly journalists. Their conclusion was the only one possible, given the documents they were provided. At the time of his death, Osama bin Laden was frustrated and isolated, a relatively powerless leader of a dying organization. In the summer and fall of 2012, Obama would use this theme as the main national security rationale for his re-election. Al-Qaeda was alternately on the run or decimated or on the path to defeat. On November 1, 2012, 5 days before the election, Obama intoned, Thanks to the service and sacrifice of our brave men and women in uniform, the war in Iraq is over. The war in Afghanistan is winding down. Al-Qaeda has been decimated. Osama bin Laden is dead. Hayes notes, the president would tout the imminent demise of Al-Qaeda more than 24 times between those attacks and Election Day. Finally, this past Wednesday, CIA Director Mike Pompeo announced the release of nearly 470,000 additional files from the Abbottabad raid. Hayes delineates how the documents show a much closer relationship between Al-Qaeda and Iran than had been heretofore assumed. He points out that Obama in his first term centered on how George W. Bush had allegedly ruined the war on terror, but the second term was focused on making a deal with the Iranian government. He adds, in a manner of speaking, Barack Obama wanted what Al-Qaeda already had, a mutually beneficial partnership with Tehran. Revealing to the American people the truth about Osama bin Laden's cozy working relationship with the Iranian government might have fatally undermined that diplomatic quest, just as the ongoing vitality of Al-Qaeda, amply testified to in the bin Laden documents, would have contradicted Obama's proud claims in 2012 that Al-Qaeda was on the run. So Obama, with the eager cooperation of some in the intelligence community, bottled up the bin Laden documents and ran out the clock. What was Obama trying to hide? Is anything about the Obama administration true? Only time will tell. The more and more we research his shenanigans, the more we learn things just don't add up, or quite frankly just don't seem to pass the smell test. Even something as cut and dry as the killing and the burial at sea of the most wanted man in U.S. history was shrouded in mystery.